What's up, Amazon sellers? If you want to know how to win more of the buy box and how repricing software works, then stay tuned, because today I'm going to interview Norm from Seller Toolkit to learn all about how repricing software works to win you the buy box and the things that you really want to know. Stay tuned. Okay, so today, obviously, I'm here with you, Norm, to obviously talk about the buy box, learn about repricing software. And first things first, thank you so much, obviously, for joining me. But if anyone doesn't know who you are and obviously the software, can I just ask you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit who you are?
Sure. I'm Norm Rogers, developer of SDK. I live here in the UK. I started SDK off as a project because we were selling on Amazon as well. My wife still does sell on Amazon, and we couldn't find out how we were making, what money we were making. So I thought this will take three or four months to put together. Started off, and here we are 5 years later, and I'm still developing the software. And I just want to build the software so that I mean, it started off as sort of we could see profit and loss, but then it became something that then I thought, well, this could be something that other Amazon sellers could use, so I built it so that other Amazon sellers could use it and keep on building and adding new features all the time. So, yeah, I'm full time on SDK, and I mean, when I say full time, I mean double full time on SDK. Yeah,
fantastic. And I think, you know, if anyone doesn't know, and hey, I use SDK in both of my Amazon businesses, UK and the US. Mm-hmm. It does a lot of things. And if I'm right in thinking, correct me, it would be profit and loss, repricing, stock reclaims, and it does a lot of, I think they're the core features.
Reconciliation of your stock, and so that you can quite easily identify where Amazon have lost your stock and where you need reimbursements. It does it all very semi-automatically, or automatically as it is possible with Amazon with reconciliation.
Yeah. And hey, I will say it's some really great software, hence why obviously I've tried a lot of different software, even the repricing side and, you know, the stock reclaim and even the P&L, and out of all that, obviously I choose to use yours, so thank you so much. And it's not even because you give it to me for free, you don't, I do pay you, obviously even the full price as well. So obviously today we're here to talk about the buy box, we're talking about, should we say, repricing and, you know, even repricing software and not like how that kind of works. So if anyone's watching right now, let's just go through the basics. Buy box, what is it? How does it work?
There are so many myths, what I find, about the buy box. And I started the SDK, or especially Seller Toolkit, people might be wondering what SDK is. But so I started playing around with repricing around about 4.5 years ago. And I then didn't know how the buy box worked. I believed everything I saw on YouTube or on Facebook. And I didn't find that's how it worked at all. People were saying about reviews. I have not seen any evidence that your buy box is split because of number of views. I couldn't see any evidence that you'd get priority or you'd get sales if you weren't the lowest. You know, so some people saying, I wasn't in the buy box, but I got a sale. And I'll say, no, you were in the buy box. Or the other thing about buy box, I'll say quite now, is that there is more than one buy box. But Amazon don't always tell the repricer that there are two buy boxes. But the buy box is generally, and there are a few caveats, generally given to the lowest price with the quickest delivery. Like, you're a new seller and you have zero reviews and you're competing with somebody that's got 10,000 reviews, I have seen no evidence that you will not share the buy box if you're the same price with them, 50-50. And I've never not seen any evidence that you will get it, more likely get it if you've got a bit more reviews. And what I like to say as well about it is, if that were the case, it was because you had more reviews, new sellers would never be able to sell a thing unless they underpriced by a penny. If you underpriced by a penny, then the other guy's going to underprice by a penny, so you're going to be even. So we would have never been able to start or sell a thing if it was based on reviews. And obviously I've got millions of data points now on repricing. I don't take all those millions, I take a few hundred thousand down, and I do my research on those. I mean, that's my artificial intelligence, it's real intelligence. I'm looking at real figures, and I found that in 99% of the cases, I did this study probably about a year ago, actually, and I do sometimes, that 99% of the cases, the buy box is owned, prime, I'm talking about prime, if you're the lowest prime. But FBM will get it if they're lower by a certain percentage. You're always going to have a time for delivery of 3-4 days, depending where you are in the world. But I'm talking about UK here. Whereas with prime, you're always going to have delivery next day. But if there's prime delivery that it's in stock, and you'll see sometimes on the listing, you'll see prime has a delivery of, where are we today? 7th of December. It'll say the 10th of December, 11th of December, but you're Prime. So, but you won't get the buy box. Again, you'll be treated very similar to FPM because you are not next day delivery. So it's about delivery and price. And there's an algorithm within Amazon that decides what the difference in those prices are, who gets it. So FBM will get it if they're low enough. If you're not next day delivery, you'll get it if the next Prime is too high. So it depends on the margins in between. Now, I am doing a lot of studying on those margins to find out what they are, because they seem to change based on cost of the item. So a £20 item, you can't just turn around and say it's 10 or 5%. It might be 10 or 5%, but it won't necessarily be if it's a £100 item. That's what I've found. But sometimes it will be. So it's, I'm trying to figure out, that's one of the things I'm figuring out in the background, what will be that difference. So it's essentially price and delivery time is the main focus. Now, when you go to the States, it's slightly different because delivery times are going to be different depending on where you are in the States. All the states are going to have fulfillment centers. I don't believe there's a state that doesn't have a fulfillment center, but there's a slightly difference. There's a slight difference. And with Amazon's feed that you get about price changes, you don't get one for New York, you don't get one for California, you just get the one. And then, so when you go on a listing, you might turn around and say, well, how comes this item's got the buy box, but on your software it says this item's got a buy box? I can't really help that. That's what Amazon's telling me. But it changes. The idea is if you're the lowest, if you price competitively, you'll get the buy box. And the other myth with thing is rotating is that it's not going to rotate if you're a penny higher. If you're a penny higher, you're not going to get the buy box. People say you do, and people have sent me information saying, well, why has this got a buy box? Well, my girlfriend goes in on her account, I go on my account. They might be different, but they tend to be if you're logged in as Prime, not logged in, or logged in as FBM. And it does depend which ones you get shown. But there are generally two buy boxes. One if you're Prime and one if you're not Prime. So you can have an FBM showing on one account and the Prime showing on the other account. If you're Prime, you'll see the Prime. If you're not Prime, you might see the FBM if it's low enough. And again, if you go Prime, you might see the FBM if it's low enough. So it's convoluted like that. But if you're competitive and you're pricing slightly above the FBM or matching Prime, you should be getting the buy box. The whole idea is to be competitive. You don't have to undercut everybody, you just be competitive. It's just like if any retailer out there, they're going to look in at Tesco's and Sainsbury's, they're selling a can of baked beans for one selling, I don't even know how much a can of baked beans is, right? One selling for 25p, one selling for 26p. They're going to match. They're going to say, well, we'll sell it at 25p too. You know what I mean? So retailers will work in the same way. What I say to a lot of people, especially in the reprice of videos, is that think like a retailer. You know, a lot of people who come into Amazon are thinking of, I must make 30% ROI on this item. I must make 50% ROI. I've got my cutoff there at 30%. But if the market is going below 30% and you're not, you're not selling. Does the price come back? I've gone off a bit off target. I do this all the time, tangent. So the thing is, the most important thing about buy box is stop listening to the myths. And underprices will always be there. You decide where you follow them or you don't decide to follow them. People that will say, well, I price mine at 10% higher than the Prime because I want to make more money, then you're not going to make a sale. Like I said, it's not going to rotate around you if you're a higher price. And this is where you've got to think about Amazon being the business they are. Why would they give their customer, not your customer, their customer a higher priced item with the same delivery as the featured item? Why would you think that you're pricing £1 higher, you're going to get the featured box, the buy box, the featured listing on that item if you're a pound higher? You're going to cause a problem with customers. The customers are going to complain, say, why are you offering me an item that's £1 more than the lowest price Prime item? And I've done this to prove what I'm talking about. I do this. I go on as a customer and complain to customer complaints team, and they do a live chat. And I've done it 3 or 4 times now. The first time I got a £5 voucher. And it was called Kellogg's Corn Flakes, probably a pack of 3 or something, and they were offering, I could do it on 2 different, non-signed in and signed in, and I was getting different results, and I was getting a Kellogg's Cornflakes for, I think it was £2 more than the cheapest Prime with the same delivery, but not when I was signed in on the account. I complained about that, went through the whole thing, I had to send them screen prints, and they said, I'm really sorry about that. That shouldn't happen. And what they are, they're glitches. They're Amazon glitches. Amazon sometimes take time to rotate that buy box because at the end they're just software. At the end they've still got the same problems. They've got billions of price changes going on and something drops out. And I'm saying that these are definitely glitches. People see that and go, well, how comes I'm here? And I'm telling you that's a glitch. And I complain about it. And then normally within half an hour, it's changed and gone to the correct listing. So these kind of things that people see cause the myths. And then there's the myths about that's because you're nearer the fulfillment center. No, it's not. Nothing to do with fulfillment center. Now that's because it's rotating around there, and like it's got an algorithm to allow a 2% difference in trying to get the buy box. You know, that's going to rotate around 2%. No, it rotates around the same price. And I have no evidence whatsoever that I have seen that it's any different to that. And I say 99% because sometimes in the 1%, I see the things like the cornflakes. So it changes in time, but it can take several hours for it to change, but it will change. So if anybody ever sees this, goes, oh, I've definitely seen it at a higher price, rotate. Just keep clicking refresh, and eventually it will go to the lowest priced.
Interesting. Wow. By God, so much.
Exactly.
So much. Wow, honestly, so much there. And I'm just trying to kind of compute it all because there's a lot of stuff you're sharing.
Mm-hmm.
I think if anyone's watching this right now, let's just bring it back. What is the buy box?
What is the buy box? So we've got a listing, your listing, and it'll have every seller's offer. So you could have 20 offers, 30 offers, you might have 3 or 4 offers. And you've all got your own offer price. And your offer price could be, if say the item sells around about £20. So you've got a prime seller selling for £20. You've got another prime seller selling for £21.50. Another one selling at £22. So who is Amazon going to give the buy box to? Or the featured listing, the featured offer. So when you go onto Amazon and you click on your ASIN or you're looking for cornflakes, you go in there, it's going to show you the one with that is the lowest cost with the quickest delivery. That's the buy box. The featured item you first go in has got the buy box. There you'll have a buy box. You have the button over there say buy now. So if you buy now, you're buying that £20 item. It will also then turn around and say, well, there are other offers from £21.50. And you can click on that £21.50 and then see all the listings. So you'll see the £20 at the top, the £21.50 and the £22 and so on. And you could, if you were mad enough, click on the £22, say I'm going to buy from the £22 guy and I'm going to pay £2 more than it's on offer for because I like the name of this company. If you wanted to, then you're buying something out of the buy box. I don't know a customer in the world that would do something as dumb as that, but they obviously do. I mean, we've sold things, it was currently priced at £4.60. Our listing was £12, and it sold at £12. And I said, that's not possible. It really isn't possible. Only my wife, Sarah, then said, no, what happens is that they're a repeat customer. So they've got their email when they bought it last time from Amazon, and they click on the link to rebuy. So they haven't gone to the listing, they've gone straight to your offer and bought again. So that's the other thing when people say, I wasn't in the buy box, and how comes I sold that? Why I must have great repricing software. No, you haven't. It's got nothing to do with that, which is fluke. And so that was a fluke, and it will be a fluke if somebody goes and says, I'm going to buy it at £22, even though the lowest offer is £20. You know, it's insane. I'm sure people do it all the time, but that will be the only time that you sell something at a higher price than what the current featured offer. The featured offer is the buy boxed offer. So that essentially is all the buy box is whoever Amazon decides has got the lowest offer, quickest time.
Fantastic. Hey, thank you. I'm still processing everything that you're saying. So if someone's starting out, the buy box is when you go to any listing, there'll be multiple people on the listing and it'll be the name of the person who, when you click the buy now, that's the person who makes the sale.
Correct.
And obviously I'm an Amazon seller, so we're always competing for the buy box. If I clarify what you've told me, the gurus, the people on YouTube, you know, hey, maybe even myself as well, and I'm sure I've said this, is that the buy box rotate, you know, it doesn't rotate. it's that lowest price depending on delivery. So it's a balance between price and delivery. Just clarify, what does that mean? Do you know where that kind of like, is it generally within a couple of days, then the lowest price? Or how does that balance between delivery and...
Well, delivery with your Prime, especially in the UK, not so much in the US. Prime is next day delivery. For the whole of the UK, I think there's like, apart from like some of the islands and off of Scotland, which has always been a thing with postage, okay? So you're always gonna get next day delivery with Prime. That's gonna be the priority for the featured listing. It's gonna be the priority because you're Prime and you're in stock. If you just have sent your items in and they're going through the fulfillment center, but they've not been unpacked yet, or they've not been checked in yet, even though it's receiving, they know that that can't go into the bucket or whatever it would be in the FC to say that it can be picked from there. So it's in transition from going to there. So therefore, the FC have put a delivery time on that of say 2-3 days time before they can get it out of box and get it in the bucket to be sold. So if you're that's why you might have Prime not available next day. So your items are, you say, well, why are my items not available? And it's arrived, it's receiving, it's not in the bucket to be sold. So FC is saying it's going to take a couple of days for that to be sold. So therefore, if you're at £20 and your items are still at the fulfillment center not ready, and they're saying it's not till the 15th of December, and I'm at £20 for the same item and I'm next day, I'm getting the buy box. You're not. In fact, if I was at £22, there's a good possibility within that 10%, good possibility I could still have the buy box. And that's why we've got the process of saying, well, you can price slightly higher than these guys who haven't yet got their stock ready to go. It's not their fault, it's the FC. You can price slightly higher and still be the featured listing because you've got quicker delivery and you're within a margin of the lowest price. So the lowest price may not have the buy box at that point simply because they have delivery, which is, it could be another week's away, so a few days away. So all that comes into it, length of time as well and price. So you have to, it's very, very difficult to work out what that margin is.
Yeah. And I'm guessing obviously that's within the own Amazon algorithm, and that could be tweaked, we say, depending on certain factors.
It could be tweaked on all sorts. It could be time of day. You know, if it's something that's time of day, then it's going to be very difficult then to hone in, you know, drill down to those algos. But I'm not going to give up trying. Yeah. I might go, this is ridiculous because it's not worth it. But it could be down to category. It could be down to to the region you're in. UK is always next day. America isn't. It just is, you know, because when I first put in one of the rules saying not next day delivery, all the US sellers use SDK goes, what's next day delivery? Oh, you don't have that? I thought that's the whole thing of Prime everywhere. Do you know what I mean?
2 day in America.
Yeah, I didn't know that. So I've got to change the wording of that. So yeah, so it's 2 days and... But I still have it as next day because as far as Amazon's concerned, it's saying it's ready for delivery. You know, it's ready to be dispatched on that day. So I'm going to change it to be dispatched on day. So if your items are ready to be dispatched, then you're going to get the priority.
Okay, so if I just clarify, generally speaking, from what we've seen so far, it's based on fulfillment and price and the blend of the two. As long as it's pretty much next day or it'll be the next day thing, the next day person or 2 day in the US, and the lowest price. Now, if you have two sellers, what you're seeing, if they're the same fulfillment and one is even a penny higher, they're really not winning that buy box.
Correct.
Sitting on that lowest price.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. You talked something about, it does rotate sometimes around that percentage difference. So let's say, for example, if you have two different fulfillment options, one might be 2 day and one might be next day. And if the 2 day merchant fulfilled, for example, is lower, and I think you kind of said maybe about the 10%, and I'm not saying exactly,
no.
But that is if the slightly slower delivery, but not too slow, is up to or more than 10% below the FBA, then that might win the buy box.
Correct.
But no, but you did say something there, or should say the other example, do it the other way, how you got a merchant fulfilled, call it $20, and then FBA comes in, they can charge $22, for example. top end and they might win it still, so you need to play. But you did say something there that that percentage, and we call it 10%, does vary what you're seeing is on the price of the product. Yeah. Tell me about that.
Having a conversation with an STK repricer user, and he was asking me what he should set his percentages to and above. And I was telling him that you've got to tweak it because this is a higher price. Because what he was seeing, he had it set at 10% for everything. So whether it was £20 or £100, he had it set for 10%. And he wasn't getting the buy box because at £100, that's now £110. So £110 is quite a lot more than somebody who was selling it for £102. So it's just that percentage then, I believe, and it's still yet to be proven, so probably going to be too high at £100 mark. Although 10%, 2%, £2 on a £20 item is still the same percentage, it's not still seen as the same value. There's a value difference. So that's a £2 difference. I'm not saying you will get it at £2. £2 may be too much even at that price. But certainly £10 at £100 is quite a big margin. You know, so it's, there's a pound thing. There's a dollar amount as well that's included in that.
I understand you're saying, even say for example, if you take it £1,000 or 10% of that is 100, you're like, well, I could just buy Prime for like £70 and get it next day. So the 100 is too much, even though technically it's 10%. So there is a weighting in regards to price somewhere.
Exactly. That's exactly the word I would use. There's some form of weighting in there. Yeah. And this is the type of thing I'm trying to look into to make it even. I'd like to be able to make the percentages algo rather than people having to put those in, because then you don't have to worry about it. Yeah. SDK is going to manage it for you. But until I've discovered what those weightings are, what those percentages are, I can't do that. I've got to leave it to you guys to like set that. And I always say, tweak it. You know, if it's not working in your category, if it's not working on that item, it's not working on an item that's £100 rather than £20, tweak it, move them into different rules, and then and try that and try and find your sweet spots in that way. But until I work it out.
Hey, honestly, really interesting. So let's just clarify. Buy box is one. Generally speaking, we're not saying exactly, it's still work in progress. Fulfillment, short as possible. And a balance between fulfillment and price. And then we talk about the 10% rule roughly, saying that if it's FBM or if it's FBA, you can be about 10% over FBM. But that does have a limit. If you go closer to like 100, it's gonna cause a problem. So that's interesting. Explain how that works when maybe a user isn't, should we say, a Prime customer. How does that work?
Right, so if you are not a Prime customer and you're signed into your account, you are going to have to pay extra shipping on a Prime item. So if FBM is at £18 and Next Prime is at £20, if you signed in as a Prime customer, you're probably going to see the £20 Prime because that's got a delivery of tomorrow. If you sign in non-Prime, you're probably going to see the FBM at £18 because your £20 Prime offer won't be next day because you're non-Prime, plus you're going to have to pay a shipping charge because you're non-Prime. So that £20 would be actually £20 plus your shipping, £2-3, so it's £22-3. So £22-3 is way above the £18. So that's why you see a difference in the buy box, because the Prime is now more expensive than it would be if you're a Prime customer. And if you go sign on Prime and FBM is at 18 with 3 days delivery, and the Prime is at £20 next day delivery, it's gonna get priority, probably get priority over the £18. The £18, £20 still is the algo we're talking about, but you're probably gonna see the Prime offer because it's next day and it's £20. So if you are a customer, you said, why are you showing me that Prime offer? Your Prime offer showing me that offer at £20 when the cheapest is at £18. You're like, well, you're a Prime customer and you're going to get that for free delivery and you're going to get it next day. That's why, because you're Prime, you're showing that. So yeah, you're paying that little bit extra, but you're going to get it tomorrow, not next week or 2 weeks time. So that's why you get two buy boxes.
And hey, that's interesting, because that also makes me think as an Amazon seller, like what, you know, maybe per product, what percentage of my sales are non-Prime? And as a result, that could have an impact on how I price, and obviously what percentage are Prime. So it could have a really big impact on maybe how I do my pricing strategy around what's the breakdown of sales and the way that works. And am I missing out? You know, is my Prime price too high that I'm not getting the non-Prime purchases? And could I, by reducing it, actually increase the non-Prime purchases?
Well, exactly. And that's why like the repricer works. So you can turn around and say, well, look, hone in on who's the cheapest at the moment on that listing within the delivery times. So you'd hone in on the prime because you know that's what you'd want to do. You hone in on prime, but if FBM is the lowest, you want to be saying, well, there's no point in me, and if FBM's lowest and he's got the buy box, there's no point in trying to like be the same price as the prime because you're not going to make the sale. So should I sell at 10% higher than the FBM, which could be lower than the lowest prime? Now, if the lowest prime was getting the buy box, you wouldn't have to because you then just matched the prime. But if the FBM is lower and you're not getting sales because FBM's got the buy box, then you're going to say, well, if I price 10% above him, I should get the buy box.
Yeah. No, I understand. Hey, I understand. So obviously I've drilled your brain for knowledge about repricing, but obviously, you know, I know obviously you do not just repricing, but obviously with Seller Toolkit, STK, obviously it's an amazing bit of software. If anyone right now is obviously interested to know about STK, what it does, and obviously it does amazing work on repricing, is using that knowledge you use there, you know, what should they know about STK if maybe they're interested, maybe the repricing side, but also what else it does? Let's tell me a bit about that.
Well, from its basic point, it's showing you your profit and loss from your sales, your profit and loss from your business, and you can put all your expenses in. So you've got from the dashboard a quick glance view of your business, and the sales and business are separated so that you know what your sales are doing. Whereas a lot of software just throw everything into one, and you can't tell what your sales were. Did you make a profit on your sales today? Yeah, sure, I've got expenses, but I don't want my accountant's expenses of £500 a month coming off my sales profit today and then showing that I actually made a £200 loss today, which a lot of software do. It's just pointless and ridiculous. So you have your sales different. So from a basic point, you're going to see a dashboard with all your information about your business and all separated in different views so that you can really see where your profit and loss are if you're not making a profit. It shows all your orders, and you can filter by your orders or what type of orders, pending, shipped, refunded, all your inventory, and you can reprice manually on your inventory. You don't have to go into a seller's toolkit, Seller Central. You can, one of the great features as well, if you don't have a repricer, is that you don't have to just put the price in. You can actually say, well, I want to make 10% ROI. You type your 10% ROI in, it calculates the price, you put save, and it sends that price into Seller Toolkit. So they're all the basics of Seller Toolkit. I think the best part, I mean, repricing is fantastic, but the best part is the reconciliation of your inventory and knowing where your inventory is and whether Amazon actually owe you any money. 90% of the cases, probably far more than that, Amazon are pretty good at doing your reimbursements if you lose items. But a lot of the time, they, because of their systems are rubbish, they really are, that items that were damaged at the fulfillment center, it's marked as damaged at the fulfillment center, but after 30 days, you haven't received your reimbursement. So STK says, you've not received your reimbursement. But more than that, it tells you exactly where all your inventory is. And it took a long time to work out how to do this because there's a lot of information in Amazon's reports which just doesn't tie up. It's, you've got information on that report, information on that report, but you can't put the whole thing together. And the inventory adjustment report just doesn't give you enough information. It tells you it's got all these codes and things moving around and whatever. But it's very hard to drill down and work out exactly where your inventory is, what happened to it. So STK, I spent a long, long time trying to get this right. It took three months of non-stop work to get it built, to get the basic parts of it built. And then I started like doing the reimbursement part and it was working. And what I did, I used to, if they said, no, you've been reimbursed, I say, no, I haven't, and give them more information from STK. And some of these emails trails would go on for like 23 back and forths.
Wow.
But I used that to learn. I used that to learn what they were doing, what I was doing, whether I needed to fix the STK up, reconciliation process up, to understand what theirs were doing. And then I got to understand what their information was coming back was always wrong. I can't remember what it used to come back with because it's all changed now, but it used to say net adjustment minus two. Yeah. And then therefore you were owed nothing. I said, well, what's that net adjustment minus two? Because I'd give them then be able to go back with what STK's worked out and says, these are available, these are inbound, these are lost damage, this is that, and this shows two missing. So there's that two missing is your net adjustment of two. Why are you saying that you've done net adjustment of two and telling me you've just like made that net adjustment two up bears no resemblance to anything. I know now I've got two missing, and then I say pass this on to a manager, and then I'll get my reimbursement. So I used it as a very much of a learning thing to work out what their process was doing so that I could beat it.
So some really powerful software, but also a lot of effort and a lot of love and passion put into it. And I can see that with how you're talking now.
Yeah.
And knowledge as well, like really testing it. I can see that. And obviously I use it as well. So question if anyone's watching right now, if they wanna see the software, maybe like, do you have like a Facebook group or a website for it? How can they see more?
Right, we're pretty bad at the website. Everything's been word of mouth up until now in Facebook groups. The link to Facebook, to Seller Toolkit is...
I'll drop it down below. Carry on.
Do that again?
No, sorry. Yeah, I'll drop it down below. Right. How can they see it? Is there a Facebook group that they can contact you through or have a, you know, join, yeah, learn
so,
more?
So you can join the Facebook group, which if you just do a search for Seller Toolkit, Ultimate Software, there's one for repricer. You won't get in the repricer unless you've got a repricer. If you want to know more, or you just join up on their Facebook group. That's all we have is a Facebook group at the moment. And you can ask anything. I mean, the best way, and if people say, well, what does your software do? The best way is to try it.
Yeah,
you've got 14 days, completely free trial. Yeah, you do have to sign up and set up a direct debit, but you can cancel that. I mean, not many people do. I'll be totally honest, not many people do, because the main thing that I get from a response from people that first get the software is, wow, I wish I had this 6 months ago.
No, I agree.
Yeah, and that's what you get, especially, now you won't get access to the reconciliation process until your free trial is over, but once you get that over, you're gonna see everything in all your reconciliation. And more importantly, all the reimbursements you're gonna see that are overdue. Yeah. And that's the thing, that you just click on overdue reimbursements, give you a list, and you click on the icon, it gives you the templated email, you just copy that into a case, and the case is set up and done. Fantastic. There are a few issues with the cases at the moment because they're like, their auto responses are a bit, but I'm working on that of being able to divert their auto response.
Fantastic, well thank you so much for joining me, and obviously it's been a real pleasure to learn about repricing and obviously the software as well, and hopefully obviously a lot of people are gonna see it, and obviously, you know, I use it, I think it's an amazing bit of software. So thank you so much for your time and everything you've done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.